Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Super 8, An Illustrated History, by Danny Plotnick, read by Eric Jason Martin. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to diagrams and graphics present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Super 8 is dead. Long live Super 8. What the hell is this book? Ever since I picked up a Super 8 camera back in 1985, people have been saying that Super 8 is dead. In a way, they're right. By 1985, companies had all but stopped making Super 8 cameras and projectors. But, in a way, all those doomsayers were also wrong. Kodak was still manufacturing Super 8 film, and though no new equipment was rolling off the assembly lines in Rochester, Nagano, or Munich, you could still pick up used equipment or dead stock in a big city or backwater camera shop. Sure, the lab support wasn't as robust as it was for those shooting on 16mm or 35mm film, but you could still carve out a space as an up-and-coming filmmaker using Super 8. You could hone your chops and perfect your craft with this home movie medium, a medium that was being plowed under by the burgeoning home video industry. But 1985 was a long time ago. All the equipment that wasn't snatched up in 1985 sat in flea markets, pawn shops, and thrift stores, getting older and older, parts decaying and corroding as the years passed. In 2019, you can still pick up used equipment, but that equipment is more than 30 years old. In the intervening decades, Kodak continued to eliminate film stocks, and in many respects, Super 8 is even more dead in 2019 than it was in 1985. But true believers continued to shoot Super 8 and craft beautiful images out of this beleaguered but beloved film gauge. This book looks back at the history of Super 8, explores how the medium has evolved through the years, and provides a glimpse into what it was like to be a no-budget artist in the pre-digital age. Filmmaking was expensive business, and Super 8 offered a low-cost alternative for young people wanting to use film to say something about the times in which they lived. How did they go about it when there was still plenty of equipment to be found and enough labs to support their filmmaking practice? In particular, this book explores the challenge of making sync sound films in Super 8, a methodology that took a major hit in 1996 when Kodak discontinued sound Super 8 film. In 2015, Super 8 celebrated its 50th birthday, bringing it that much closer to death. But don't worry, as much as Super 8 is pretty much dead, it's still very much alive. Kodak plans to unveil a new Super 8 camera in 2019, possibly breathing new life into a decaying body. Dead, but not quite dead. Danny Plotnick, 2019. Chapter 1. What is Super 8? You can talk about Super 8 from a purely technological perspective. The Super 8 motion picture format was developed by Kodak in 1965. Super 8 has smaller sprockets than its precursor, regular 8, sometimes referred to as standard 8, which means the Super 8 image is spread across a larger swath of its 8mm celluloid strip than regular 8. As a result, the Super 8 image is almost 50% larger than the 8mm image, therefore containing more information and producing an image with greater definition than its predecessor. At the time, the other movie format on the block that was accessible to the general public was 16mm, which, by virtue of its 16mm wide celluloid palette, contained more than three times the information of either of the 8mm formats. You can also talk about how Super 8 fits into the continuum of film history. Both 16mm and regular 8mm had been around for decades prior to Super 8's release. The 16mm format was born in 1923, regular 8 followed in 1932. Throughout the years, 16mm was used for a variety of purposes. Until the release of regular 8 in the 1930s, 16mm was the principal home movie format of choice in the U.S. In the 1940s, it was used by combat cameramen in World War II. In the 1950s, it found widespread use in the educational, television news, and industrial film markets. In the 1960s, it became the favored gauge of documentary, experimental, and independent filmmakers from Cassavetes to Godard to Pennebaker to Brackage. Shooting in 16mm offered a beautiful image at a fraction of the cost of 35mm film. Meanwhile, Regular 8 solidified itself as the stalwart of the home movie world. While the image quality of Regular 8 didn't pop as much as 16mm, it was a substantially cheaper format. The 8mm cameras, projectors, editing gear, and film stock were a fraction of the cost of 16mm equipment and accessories. This affordability made it the format of choice for dads wanting to document family birthdays, vacations, and graduations. Upon its arrival, Super 8 quickly dominated the home movie market, supplanting Regular 8 for market share. Not only did it have a superior image compared to Regular 8, but it was much simpler to operate. Regular 8 was a tricky beast. It came in 25-foot rolls that were 16mm wide that you needed to manually thread into your camera. Because the camera's film gate was only 8mm wide, when you shot, you only exposed 8mm, or half of the film strip. You shot for 25 feet, roughly 1 minute and 50 seconds, at which point you needed to pull the film out of the camera, flip it over, rethread it, and then shoot the 25-foot roll a second time, this time exposing the other 8mm of film. You would ship the finished reel to a lab for processing, where they split the film lengthwise and spliced the two 25-foot sections together, giving you a 50-foot film reel, approximately 3 minutes and 40 seconds in length and 8mm wide. Super 8 was significantly less cumbersome. The film came in a 50-foot, light-tight cartridge that simply popped into the camera's film chamber. It took a mere matter of seconds to insert the cartridge, and presto, you were ready to shoot. That process was no more difficult than popping videotape into a camcorder. No muss, no fuss. Additionally, there was no significant price difference between Super 8 and Regular 8. Super 8 had a better image and was easier to use. It was an easy choice to make for home movie enthusiasts. Kodak and Bell and Howell were the first manufacturers to jump into the Super 8 pool, and even they were surprised at how well the new format caught on and how quickly it displaced standard 8mm in the home market. As a result of the new gauge's success, Kodak discontinued all but one standard 8mm model by the end of 1966. Interestingly, though Super 8 took the home movie world by storm, the new format was born out of Kodak's desire to find a better format for educational, industrial, and commercial purposes. Kodak believed a better quality format would make inroads into these markets, which didn't traditionally work in 8mm, instead producing and distributing mostly on 16mm. Generating 16mm prints was expensive, so companies would sometimes create 8mm reduction prints to save money. The 8mm prints, however, were not always embraced due to the limited information carried by such a small image. Super 8's increased image area was designed with an eye on improving the overall quality of the reduction prints for the boardroom and the classroom. Super 8 also promised additional savings by lowering the cost of reduction prints. Its dimensions made it possible to make 4 Super 8 prints at one time on 35mm wide film. This would be a boon for education and business markets. At least that's how the thinking went. In a particularly savvy business move, Kodak made the industry aware of its intentions. The company recognized that it would be of significant benefit to the industry if the new format were internationally adopted and standardized, so Kodak handed over its plans to equipment manufacturers worldwide. This move paid huge dividends and helped fuel the format's rapid growth. As early as 1966, 13 companies had begun producing Super 8 cameras. That number ballooned to nearly 30 companies by 1967. Ultimately, more than 80 companies would go on to manufacture Super 8 cameras. In addition to Kodak and Bell and Howell, Canon, Nikon, Yashica, Sankyo, Argus, GAF, Bauer, and Braun were just some of the companies entering the fray. No two cameras were alike. Some were high-end, some were low-end. Some cameras were built like tanks, while others were riddled with cheapo plastic parts. Some had fantastic lenses with a wide range of zoom capability, while others had rinky-dink fixed-focus lenses. Some cameras featured a large array of manual controls, while others contained only automatic functions. All of the cameras shot film at 18 frames per second, FPS, which was not the 24 FPS industry standard. Only some of the higher-end cameras filmed at 24 FPS. With so many manufacturers producing cameras, there was no consistent set of functions on the equipment that began to flood the market. This may have contributed to the feeling that there was no clear-cut production methodology built up around the format. This lack of standardization created a space in which amateurists could develop their own style, and as a result, Super 8 took on different meanings for different people. At the outset, Super 8 production was the purview of dads documenting their family's Kodak moments. Due to its proliferation amongst suburban families, Super 8 quickly fell into the hands of teenagers who took to making backyard monster movies, parroting the no-budget style of Roger Corman and his ilk. The likes of Sam Raimi, J.J. Abrams, and Vince Gilligan cut their teeth this way. By the early 1970s, realizing that they could work at a fraction of the cost of 16mm, independent, experimental, and underground filmmakers soon got in on the action. Super 8 was becoming an international movement. Lenny Lipton dabbled in his singular brand of documentary in the Bay Area. Derek Jarman made stunning films set amidst the avant-garde world of London. Narcissa Hirsch and Claudio Caldini created experimental work in Argentina. And by the early 1980s, young filmmakers involved in the German film organization Gegenlicht embraced Super 8 as their medium of choice to document the anti-nuclear movement. From 1965 to 1972, films had to be shot silently. Accompanying soundtracks, if any, would in all likelihood be recorded onto reel-to-reel or cassette tapes to be played simultaneously with the film's projection. In 1972, sound was born. Renowned documentarian Richard Leacock worked with MIT to develop a double-system sound, Super 8 workflow. This process allowed Super 8 to function like 16mm. A Neso camera ran alongside a Sony cassette recorder, both synced at a precise 24 frames per second. The sound and picture were married in post. Editing was done on a Super 8 flatbed. The entire process was akin to 16mm. Down the street at Harvard, Bob Doyle was also working on a double system setup of his own. His system, which followed in 1973, led him to start Super 8 Sound, a company that was a critical player in the world of Super 8. Double system allowed Super 8 to function in a more traditional and professional manner. The hope was that this workflow would be appealing to both documentarians and television news-gathering services. It had the familiarity of 16mm production, but at a reduced price point. While there was a modicum of work produced in this way, double system Super 8 never became a dominant force. The cost of the initial Leacock MIT system pushed $7,000 and didn't hold sync particularly well. Doyle's system, which was much cheaper and held its sync, won out. Super 8 Sound did an incredibly brisk business, selling 2,000 units by 1976. This approach was certainly cheaper than 16mm, but with video technology just over the horizon, it was a proposition with little future. By 1980, very little Super 8 work was being produced in this fashion. The sound format that revolutionized Super 8 production was developed by Kodak in 1973. The company introduced a way to shoot single-system sound with their new Sound Super 8 film stocks and Ektasound 130 and 140 cameras. All you had to do was plug a microphone straight into your camera, start shooting, and you'd be recording sync sound directly onto your film. This was truly a game-changer. Due to its simplicity, single-system sound Super 8 opened up myriad possibilities for filmmakers, The sound film had a 0.027mm magnetic audio stripe, similar to the iron oxide tape used in audio cassettes, adhered to the edge of the film opposite the sprockets. Many filmmakers used this feature to capture sync sound on the set. If you shot silently, you could now add sound in post-production by lining a mic, turntable, or cassette deck into a sound projector that could record onto the magnetic stripe. The film also had a second, smaller stripe on its other edge, which could be accessed to add additional sounds in post-production. Kodak's Ektasound 130 camera came in at a reasonable $189.50, making it a bargain compared to the more expensive double-system universe. Bolstered by the advent of sound film, Super 8 was embraced by a new breed of filmmaker. Combining their love of music and the French New Wave, the no-wave cinema movement was born in New York City in the mid-1970s. Jim Jarmusch, Amos Poe, James Nares, John Lurie, Charlie Ahern, Vivian Dick, and Beth and Scott B. were just a few of the folks documenting the gritty urban lifestyle of their bankrupt metropolis. By the 1980s, this scene gave way to the harder-edged cinema of transgression, featuring the likes of Richard Kern and Nick Zedd. By the mid-1970s, Super 8 also began infiltrating the college ranks, with over 80 American universities offering Super 8 filmmaking courses. Due to its low cost, many universities embraced Super 8, teaching introductory production classes with the format. Super 8 provided an easier introduction to the filmmaking process than 16mm. Super 8's easy-to-load cartridges, built-in automatic light meters, and ability to record high-quality sync sound were just some of the features that made it a good format for beginners. Additionally, if you had access to mid-range or high-end cameras with nice lenses, the image quality was quite sharp. The low cost of equipment, film, and processing appealed to both university production programs and the broke college students who filled them. Media arts centers, which began dotting the landscape in the 1970s, also loved the low barrier to entry that Super 8 provided. Many young people who chose to forego the college experience received film training at these art hubs, or simply learned the medium on their own. Richard Linklater, Dazed and Confused, Boyhood, chose not to go to college for film. Instead, he taught himself the filmmaking process and made his first feature on Super 8 before he made Slacker. While it might be a stretch to claim Super 8 had an influence on the rising independent film movement that took off in the late 1980s, there's no doubt many independent filmmakers, such as Todd Haynes, Spike Lee, Wes Anderson, and Alex Gibney, framed their first shots while looking through the viewfinder of a Super 8 camera. Super 8 held great promise, but with the rise of video in the late 1970s and early 1980s, the bottom quickly fell out of the Super 8 market. Bell and Howell closed its consumer division in 1979, and Kodak stopped manufacturing Super 8 cameras in 1981. By 1985, almost no new equipment was being manufactured. As the years progressed, fewer services became available to Super 8 filmmakers, and beloved film stocks were discontinued. However, these obstacles didn't stop young people from picking up thrifted gear and trying their hand in Super 8. Why did they pick up this discarded equipment? Because there was a story they wanted to tell. Even though video was on the rise, it didn't look like film. If you wanted to produce something filmic, you had to shoot film. And Super 8, though it was often seen as a second-class citizen, was still film. If you had a good eye, a good camera, and embraced the format's limitations, you could make strong work. Due to its economical and egalitarian nature, no two Super 8 filmmakers approached their craft in the same way. Its colorful and somewhat ragtag story is told best through the personal experiences of those who dared to create something grand with a home movie medium. Could it be done? Of course it could, but it was not easy. Super 8 could be beautiful, but it was a finicky beast. As you listen to this book, you will hear many of the adventures from Super 8 pioneers who aimed for perfection in an imperfect medium. Chapter 2. Super 8. My Early Years. I started making Super 8 films by chance. It was the mid-1980s, I was in college, and I was on my way to being a history major. In a Russian history class, we viewed Sergei Eisenstein's Strike. At the film's climax, Eisenstein, ever the master editor, cross-cut workers being gunned down by government thugs with images of cows being slaughtered. This was revelatory. I had never seen anything like that before in a film. It was rebellious. It dripped with anti-authoritarian sentiment. It was a style of filmmaking far removed from anything I had previously witnessed. It had a punk rock vibe. At least, that was my takeaway. At the time, I was involved in the underground music scene, and this audacious moment in Strike struck a chord with me. I went back and watched the film two more times that week. Over the course of those viewings, I stopped wanting to be a history major and decided to become a filmmaker. I wanted to make art like that. Art that made you sit up in your seat and take notice. Eisenstein changed my life. I was an undergraduate at the University of Michigan, one of the top liberal arts schools in the country. Unfortunately for me, the film department was arguably the worst department in the school. There were only three official classes, a film history course, a video production class where you lugged around back-breaking 3/4-inch video portapacks, and a Super 8 production class. Not only was the class selection limited, but the amount of equipment available was scant, and the quality of that gear was gamey at best. I have no recollection of the kinds of cameras we used, though I can guarantee you we weren't using the top-of-the-line bronze and bullues. There was one projector available to the entire program, and it was silent. We could, and did, make sound films. However, we were only able to watch them when the professor brought his own sound projector to class. This lack of post-production sound equipment made cutting sound films nearly impossible. You had to befriend the teacher and convince him to let you borrow his equipment. He was actually nice enough about it, but I do remember some awkward trips to meet him at various locales around town to gather up the gear. When you're 19, it feels strange to interrupt your professor's adult league softball game to borrow film equipment. You follow him to his car, parked in the residential section of a college town, the trunk pops open, an exchange is made. As odd as it was, it also felt strangely adult, like you were taking control of your own life, stepping out of your comfort zone to get what you needed to make your art. Eventually, one of my classmates bought his own projector. I used it a lot. And, perhaps as a result, I starred in a horror movie of his. Was I interested in horror movies? No. Did I consider myself an actor? No. But that was the price of gaining access to a sound projector, which I needed to edit and watch rough cuts of my own movies. Was I the hero of that horror movie? A hapless, butchered victim? I'm unsure, though I'm pretty certain I don't want to head down into the archive and unearth that film. I do remember a scene of me leaning against the wall in a dorm room and looking up at a poster of Farrah Fawcett, or maybe it was a more mid-1980s appropriate pinup. Either way, I shudder just thinking about it. The point is, if you didn't have adequate resources of your own, this was simply the price you had to pay if you wanted to make movies. I soon bought a projector of my very own, a Chinon SP330MV. I bought it at a Suburban Ritz camera. They were a pretty stinky photography chain at the time, and though I never really liked the place, it's where I bought my first and only projector. It cost just over $100. It was a big purchase for me, but a necessary one. No longer would I be dependent on my professor or my horror-obsessed friend. The phrase DIY was not in use yet, but unwittingly I, along with many other Super 8 filmmakers, was heading down that path. I could borrow cameras from school. I could borrow a better camera, a GAF 805M, from my friend Mike. I could get the editing supplies from school. With my own projector in hand, I could now watch, or better yet, exhibit, the finished product. It was one thing to make a film, but if you wanted to have an impact, the way Eisenstein impacted me, you had to show your films to an audience. This was no easy task in the mid-1980s. There was no YouTube, no internet, no home for short films on TV. Most college kids didn't even have VCRs yet. Festivals and public access TV were the only outlets likely to show your films. But accessing those venues was a challenge. As a nascent filmmaker, it was hard enough to make a film. I barely knew what I was doing behind the camera, so there was no way that I had any idea how to access the festival circuit. Plus, my films were too raw, too unfinished to enter that realm. But I was passionate about the work I was doing. Perhaps I was misguided, too swayed by my youthful enthusiasm, too enamored by my own reflection, but I thought that like-minded folks would respond to my films. Sure, they were rough around the edges, but so was punk rock. With a projector now part of my arsenal, I realized that when I was done with a film, I could invite friends to my house and have a screening in the living room. The projector was lightweight, which meant I could be mobile. I could take it to a friend's house and show movies in the backyard after a barbecue. I had friends in bands. I could ask them if I could show a film before their sets. I could pack up that projector, set it up on a table in a bar, and let the show begin. I wasn't going to wait for the people to find me. I was going to take the show to the people. I was taking matters of distribution into my own hands. I was making it up as I went. Honestly, I had no idea what I was doing. I was learning on the fly. Why did I choose Super 8? At the time, the prevailing reason to use Super 8 was because it was significantly cheaper than 16mm or 35mm. But that wasn't my motivation. I chose Super 8 because that was the format of choice in the class that my college offered. I didn't know any other world or what any other options were. No one ever explained to me the difference between any of the formats. Had U of M offered a 16mm class, I'm sure I would have forged a career with those tools. Had there only been a 3/4-inch video class, I'm sure that would have been my gauge of choice. Simply put, I didn't know any better. I just took what was in front of me and ran with it. Case Study: Skate Witches. Of all my films, Skate Witches is the one that has thrived in the internet age. This is somewhat fascinating and perplexing to me. The film was made in the space of an afternoon in Ann Arbor, Michigan, in 1986. The plot involves a gang of female skateboarders who terrorize the boy skateboarders in town. Though their skating leaves a bit to be desired, they talk a mean game, push boy skateboarders off their boards, have pet rats, and sport badass leather jackets with their crew name stenciled in white paint. Did I mention the film clocks in at just under 2 minutes? I imagine that has something to do with its internet success. What fascinates me is that this was one of my first films. As will become evident as you listen to this book, Super 8 was an unforgiving medium. For someone like me, who was self-taught, unforgiving meant that the early films were chock-a-block full of mistakes. Skate Witches is riddled with problems. When I taught Super 8 classes, this was one of the first films I showed. I did this not as a back-patting power move, but to show off both how beautiful Super 8 could be if shot well, and to demonstrate how easy it was to fall victim to Super 8's shortcomings. Perhaps I should start with the beauty. Skate Witches was shot on Kodachrome 40 on a bright, sunny summer day. This combination meant that the blue sky popped. The rich hues of the green trees were on display in their full Midwestern bloom. The red shingled rooftops shimmered, and the flesh tones were vibrant and pink flushed. Skate Witches really did show off Kodachrome's hypersaturated color palette. The video transfers the film received over the years have never done the color true justice. To see the beauty of the Kodachrome, you really need to be looking at a film projection of the Kodachrome original. But the film has its problems as well. Problems a first-time filmmaker would encounter. The film opens with a blast of hardcore. Factions skate and destroy, shreds over the film's opening credit, a shot of the Skate Witches logo emblazoned across one of the witches' leather jackets. The song was pulled from a cassette comp the Queen Witch had. To get it onto the film, I lined a cassette player into my projector. The projector had the ability to record sound directly onto the film's magnetic audio stripe. The only problem being that the projector's record button made a god-awful electronic squawking whenever you engaged or disengaged it. That wasn't a problem on the front end of the film, because I pressed record while the film's silent leader was passing through the projector. The problem was when I pressed stop on the record button in the middle of the first scene of the film. An unholy screeching, like someone pushing a needle across a record, was forever tattooed on the film's soundtrack. This taught me a lot about what not to do in the future, but in that moment, the unforgiving nature of Super 8 reared its ugly head, and as a result, that sound forever remains part of the film's soundtrack. In the digital universe, I've had several opportunities to clean up that mess, but I've always chosen to leave it. It's an authentic mistake that has been part of the film for over 30 years. Why fix it now? Strangely, on the internet, where many great things and many horrific things have been said about the film, no one has ever complained about that fucked up bit of audio. The sound fart drives me nuts, but the internet hordes couldn't care less. Go figure. I imagine if I cleaned it up, someone would inevitably complain about that. The other mistake that you can find in every shot is a pulsing light meter. All Super 8 cameras have a built-in automatic light meter. I hadn't quite gotten the hang of the best way to use that back in 1986. You would engage the light meter by pressing the camera's trigger in halfway. When you got to the halfway point, it would take the meter a second to stabilize and find the right f-stop reading. Once the meter stabilized, you were ready to shoot. Sadly, that's not how I was rocking things back then. To conserve film, I would yell, "Action!" And the second the Skate Witches started delivering lines, I'd press the trigger in full bore. This meant that the light meter was hunting for the f-stop as the action was unfolding. At the head of each shot of the film, you can see this pulsing take place. Live and learn. And I did. I never made that mistake again, but it lives on in Skate Witches. Again, nobody ever complains about that mess either. The other strange development is that, though I spent a lot of money getting quality Super 8 transfers of my films, the version of Skate Witches that has caused an internet ruckus is a compromised transfer. In the 1990s, I transferred the film to 1-inch, a high-end video stock. When 1-inch lost favor, the transfer was duped to Beta SP, another high-end tape stock. When it came time to move into the digital world in the early 2000s, I dumped all my Beta SP down to Mini DV and brought the films into the computer world from the Mini DV tapes. Even with these generational losses, the high-quality transfers still looked good. But for some reason, Skate Witches never made it to the Mini DV from Beta. I don't know why. So, when I digitized my films, I had two choices. I could pay a transfer house to digitize the Beta, or I could digitize the film myself using a VHS dub I had of the original 1-inch transfer. Digitizing the Beta would have cost me between $60 and $100. Being the cheapskate that I am, I opted to go the VHS route. In my defense, I had no idea of the potential of this thing called YouTube. I had no idea that the film would ultimately garner almost 500,000 views. Had I known that, I would maybe have paid the $60, but at the time, it seemed like a waste of money. The generational loss from 1-inch to the lo-fi VHS was significant. The VHS had a fuzzy quality to start with. Combine that with YouTube's putrid compression settings in the mid-2000s, and the result is film quality that I cringe at whenever I see it on YouTube. But again, nobody seems to complain. They all think it adds to the 1980s charm. They think it's an intentional artifact. They have no idea how I die a bit inside each time I see it. Another reason I chose to not spend the money on digitizing Skate Witches is that during the period when I was actively producing Super 8 films, people liked Skate Witches well enough, but it was never the film people went gaga over. When it was released, there wasn't even a market for this type of film. In 1986, festivals and cinematheques were the venues that showed short and experimental films. Those venues gravitated toward a more conventional interpretation of experimental filmmaking. Skate Witches was not that. It had a foot firmly planted in the mosh pit. While there was precedent for this type of film from the no-wave years, unless you were from New York or an established art star, it was harder for films of this nature to gain any traction. Ann Arbor, where the film was shot, had one of the top 8mm film festivals in the country, and I'm not making this up, Skate Witches was rejected from the festival. To add insult to injury, each year the festival gave away a prize to the best film made in Michigan. That year, they gave the award to a filmmaker from Ohio. In their estimation, they didn't find one worthy Michigan-made Super 8 film. Giving that award to someone from Ohio was tantamount to fighting words for a Michigander. It would be a couple of years, but that festival would eventually come around to my work. I would ultimately win a Best in Fest in 1990 for my film Steel-Belted Romeos, but that was 4 years after Skate Witches was rejected. The point being that films with attitude had trouble finding a home in the mid-1980s. Underground films with this kind of aesthetic would ultimately find a following, but that didn't really take off until the explosion of the underground film festival scene, which kicked off with the birth of the New York Underground Film Festival in 1994. So, films like Skate Witches, made in the nether regions between the end of No Wave and the beginning of the new American underground, wandered aimlessly through the film landscape. In short, I never saw the reverence for Skate Witches coming. There were hints of excitement around the film in the late 1990s with the birth of skate film festivals like the Mid-Atlantic Skate and Sound Film Festival and art shows like the San Francisco Arts Commission's Switch Stance show, which gave skate and surf culture a serious nod. However, these were fleeting romances. My ability as a prognosticator has never been great. I certainly couldn't foresee the power of the internet and its capacity to transform how we view films and access the past. I didn't anticipate legions of people using the internet as a thrift store to unearth archaeological treasures from bygone eras. As a result, I couldn't be bothered to make a $60 investment to archive my film in a pristine fashion. Maybe I had my head buried too deep in the analog universe to foresee the future. People were still entrenched in an analog world, so forgive my blind spot. Super 8 filmmakers spent careers being ignored and passed over, so there was no reason to think this new medium would change that equation. And so I put up a crappy-looking version of a film online. Just my luck, that film would be the one to take off. The irony is rich. Though, in a bizarre way, maybe adding a lo-fi VHS sheen to a lo-fi Super 8 film was the secret ingredient to internet fame and fortune. Chapter 3. Cameras. Super 8 cameras are cool, small and sleek, with a snazzy pistol grip. They feel good in your hand. They're lightweight, and they cozy up to your eye just right. Ideal for run-and-gun guerrilla filmmaking. You can gaff them to a skateboard or take them into the pit at a hardcore show. They are unobtrusive. They aren't intimidating. You can get intimate with your subject, unlike 16mm, which is bulky. You can see it coming a mile away. Not to mention, 16mm is complex with its external light meters, Byzantine threading patterns, and changing bags. Super 8 is smart and simple. Pop that 50-foot cartridge into the camera, and you're ready to roll in a matter of seconds. Do a quick zoom, grab your focus, take a quick meter reading with the built-in light meter, lock your exposure, and roll. 50 feet of film fly by in the blink of an eye. Not too terribly long ago, there were some rock-solid Super 8 cameras. The Canon 1014 XLS was the primo sound camera. Decked out with a mighty zoom lens, 6.5 to 65mm, f1.4, an intervalometer for time-lapse, a variable shutter, and sound recording functions, this camera had it all. Recording sound was as simple as plugging a mic into the mini input on the camera. Voila! You had sync sound filmmaking at your fingertips, something conventional 16mm production couldn't offer. The Nikon R10 was the top of the pops when it came to silent cameras, boasting an equally impressive lens, 70-70mm f1.4, and the ability to do longer in-camera dissolves, 100 frames, than the Canon 1014 XLS, 90 frames. In-camera dissolves, that was madness. In a post-production universe that was reliant on straight cuts, in-camera dissolves added major production value to your film. Not only were both of these cameras kicking out beautiful images, but they both had a heft. You could probably crack someone's skull open with one of those and your camera would still remain functional. Though they were Japanese companies, the Canons and Nikons were readily available in America. Over in Europe, Beaulieu and Braun designed beautiful cameras, featuring streamlined European craftsmanship and great glass. The Beaulieu 2008S, 4008ZM series, 5008, 6008, 7008, and 9008 even allowed for interchangeable C-mount lenses, accommodating most 16mm lenses on the market. The 4008ZM2 came equipped with a 6-66mm Schneider Optiveron f1.8 zoom lens. Schneider was one of the top lens manufacturers out there. Even today, my students stare in awe of the beauty of this camera. As Lenny Lipton astutely observed back in 1975, it's a fine French machine, looking more like Barbarella's ray gun than a Super 8 camera. No question about it, the images these dandies produced were outstanding. All of these companies had American distributors, and based on the interviews in this book, the Nizo line of cameras produced by Braun had an incredible reach and were beloved by filmmakers worldwide. The form and function of the Nizos were unparalleled. Founded in the 1920s, Nizo was a German manufacturer of movie cameras. The company nearly went bankrupt in the late 1950s and was taken over by Braun in 1962. Non-filmmakers will certainly know Braun for their razors and kitchen appliances. Braun was a company that took its industrial design seriously, and the team at Braun was headed up by renowned designer Dieter Rams. There were many beautiful Super 8 cameras produced, but Rams and Marcel Beaulieu were the only designers whose names you heard talked about in revered tones in the Super 8 world. There were less rarefied, but eminently solid, workhorse cameras as well. By 1967, there were already over 70 models of Super 8 cameras one could purchase. As the 1970s dawned, manufacturers like Agfa, Chinon, Minolta, Elmo, and Umig helped flood the market. Over the lifespan of Super 8, there were over 1,600 models available to consumers worldwide. Canon had a huge array of cameras, and many of their mid-range cameras were not only excellent, but easy to find, often found at bargain basement prices compared to the top-shelf competition. Many of these models housed very nice lenses, though with a narrower zoom range than the likes of the 1014 XLS. The Canon 514 XLS was an incredibly popular mid-range camera, sporting a 9-45mm zoom. Many of these mid-range cameras also offered sound functionality. They may not have had all the bells and whistles of their top-end brethren, but they got the job done. By 1985, with the exception of Beaulieu, companies stopped producing Super 8 cameras. You could still find them throughout the 80s and 90s by directing your attention toward fancy camera stores, scouring the classifieds, or visiting camera swaps, flea markets, and pawn shops. After all, more than 10 million Super 8 cameras had been sold to households in the U.S. before the Super 8 market crashed, so there were still plenty of used cameras to be found. All Super 8 cameras ran on AA batteries. Any shopping excursion necessitated bringing a pack of AAs. If you found a camera, saw that there were no obvious dents on the body or on the lens, and if the AAs powered it up, it was probably worth the risk. There was no standard function set on a Super 8 camera. Many of the low-end cameras had almost no functions other than a zoom lens. So, what was the range of options you might find on a Super 8? Sound. I suppose the first question you had to ask yourself if you were on the hunt for a Super 8 camera was, do I want to make sound films? If the answer was yes, then you needed a sound camera. There were both silent and sound models of Super 8 cameras, and assessing whether or not you were looking at a sound camera was easy to figure out. The sound models contained a sound head in the film chamber. There was no mistaking that component. The exterior of the cameras featured a mini input jack for the mic and a headphone jack for sound monitoring. Most of the sound cameras utilized auto levels, though a handful, like the 1014 XLS, offered some ability to control levels. Zoom. A nice zoom was essential. Almost all Super 8 cameras came with fixed-mount lenses. No interchanging of lenses went on other than a handful of exceptions like those noted previously. What was on the camera was what you got, so a nice zoom gave you options. The greater zoom range you had, the better off you would be. The range was all over the map, with a 12x zoom being the max. If you got to a 10x zoom, you were doing well for yourself. Most cameras had an auto zoom for nice, smooth zooming. For auto zooming, many cameras had one default speed, while some of the fancier cameras had variable speed zoom settings. Manual exposure. Manual exposure was a necessity in my book, though many cameras only came outfitted with automatic exposure. For Super 8 metering, you would use the auto exposure to serve as the basis for your final exposure. You could override the auto exposure and dial in an f-stop if you were in lighting conditions that proved confusing to the camera's reflected light meter. If you had manual control, you could also lock your exposure in place to ensure that your exposure wouldn't fluctuate over the course of your shot. Many cheapo cameras only had auto exposure, with no manual overrides. Some cameras had primarily auto exposure functionality, but with a couple of workarounds. A BLC, backlight control, button was commonly found on cameras, allowing the iris to open an additional stop or two if you deemed it necessary. It was used to address backlit situations, but obviously you could engage it whenever you wanted. Some cameras also came with an EE, electronic eye, or AE, auto exposure, lock. By holding this button down while shooting, you could lock your automatically generated exposure into place. This was ideal if your light values would be changing over the course of the shot. However, this was quite awkward for a shooter because you needed one finger to hold down the trigger and another finger to hold the exposure lock in place. But this was a lifesaver for cameras without true manual control of exposure. The Canon 514 XLS was one of the most popular of all Super 8 cameras, and this was the exposure situation on that camera. Speed. All Super 8s shot at 18 FPS, which was not the industry standard, given that 16mm and 35mm shot at 24 FPS. Ultimately, shooting at 18 FPS was more cost-effective. A 50-foot cartridge of film lasted 3 minutes and 20 seconds at 18 FPS and 2 minutes 30 seconds at 24 FPS, so you got more film for your money at 18 FPS. If you were planning to blow your film up to 16mm, shooting at 18 FPS was not recommended since the frame rates wouldn't match. If you were shooting subjects with a lot of motion, 18 FPS was not recommended. Beyond that, 18 FPS got the job done at a fraction of the cost. Many Super 8 cameras did allow you to shoot 24 FPS as well as other frame rates. Some cameras had fast motion and slow motion presets. Many cameras had single-frame functionality for animation, and a couple, like the Canon 1014 XLS and Nizo S560, had intervalometers, which allowed you to shoot time-lapse. Filters. The majority of Super 8 stocks were tungsten-balanced, and the cameras came with two basic filter settings to account for whether you were shooting with daylight or with tungsten light. On some cameras, the filter switch was easy to comprehend. A sun symbol indicated proper color balance when shooting in daylight. A light bulb symbol indicated proper color balance when shooting with tungsten lights. On some cameras, there was no easy-to-decipher switch. Some cameras had a movie light plug where a screw needed to be inserted into a thread on top of the camera when shooting with tungsten light. the principle being that in the home movie world, you could screw a light into that mount in order to illuminate your scene. By screwing the light in, you would trigger a mechanical train that would retract the daylight filter, type 85A, housed in the body of the camera, allowing you to shoot in tungsten light without fear. Other cameras had a filter key that operated in the same manner as the light plug. Some cameras also came with ND, neutral density, filters. Not many did, but what a nice option this was to help prevent overexposure on sunny days. Fades dissolve. Now we're moving into rarefied territory. A handful of cameras did auto fades, an even smaller subset did dissolves at the push of a button. Variable shutters. A scant few had a variable shutter, which allowed you to open the camera's shutter to a wider angle, allowing more light to get to the film gate. This was great if you knew you would be operating in low-light situations. It could buy you a stop, saving your film in certain situations. 200-foot cartridge. In 1975, Kodak unleashed the Supermatic 200 camera, which accepted a 200-foot cartridge. Kodak produced a handful of sound and silent stocks in the 200-foot configuration. All told, about 30 models accepted these larger cartridges, including a smattering of Elmo, Nizo, Chinon, Cosina, Beaulieu, and Sankyo cameras. Note: I have done my best to give the listener a sense of the lifespan and cost of Super 8 equipment by including the years of manufacture and original retail price of equipment in the U.S. Please note that I came across much contradictory information in this regard. Further complicating issues is that equipment was often previewed at trade shows in a certain year, but then released to the public at a later date. Dates of manufacture for projectors were more difficult to track down. The dates listed tend to reflect the original year of manufacture rather than the projector's lifespan. Information for editing equipment proved even more difficult. As this book is not meant to be a comprehensive catalog of Super 8 equipment, please forgive any inaccuracies. The goal is to give the listener a sense of the equipment landscape at various points along the Super 8 timeline. Equipment. Specialty cameras. Notes on specialty cameras. The preceding discussion focuses on the typical range of Super 8 cameras found on the market. These are the cameras that accepted film cartridges, and if they were sound cameras, they were single-system sound cameras. There were a handful of rare-breed cameras that bear mentioning. Double Super 8. Double Super 8 was a format that never entirely caught fire. Canon and Pathé were the only manufacturers in the pool on this one. They essentially modified 16mm cameras to work in the Super 8 realm. In a certain regard, they functioned similarly to regular 8. In other words, the film you got from Kodak came in 100-foot rolls that were 16mm wide. When you shot, you only exposed 8mm of the film. When you got to the end of your 100-foot spool, you flipped the spool over, reloaded it, and shot for another 100 feet, this time exposing the other 8mm of film. The lab would slit it, splice it, and you'd end up with 200 feet of Super 8 film. The Pathé could even accept 400-foot loads of film. On the plus side, you could shoot well beyond the 3 minutes and 20 seconds offered by conventional Super 8 filmmaking. The downside was that the hefty footprint of the camera negated the unobtrusive nature of more conventional Super 8 filmmaking. The Pathé also came in at a whopping $2,995. The Canon was a steal at $1,300. Single 8. Fuji chose to mark their own territory in the realm of 8mm filmmaking. Their single 8 format was essentially the same as Super 8, but the cartridge design was different. You couldn't load a single 8 cartridge into a Super 8 camera, and likewise, you couldn't load a Super 8 cartridge into a single 8 camera. At a technical level, in the Kodak cartridge design, the pressure plate existed inside the Kodak cartridge. The pressure plate is an essential element in a camera system that ensures your film will be in focus. In the Fuji universe, the pressure plate was not part of the cartridge system, but part of the camera. But once you got the film back from the lab, you could play a Single 8 film on a Super 8 projector and edit Single 8 with most Super 8 editing setups because the perforation size, shape, and distance between perfs was the same in both formats. Single 8 had a polyester base as opposed to Super 8's acetate base, which led to a thinner but stronger film. Due to the stronger base of Single 8, you couldn't cement splice it, so all editing of Single 8 lived in the realm of tape slices. Double system sound. One of the beauties of Super 8 was the immediacy that came from working with single system sound. You could shoot a film, and as soon as it came back from the lab, you could be editing on a top-of-the-line edit system that was about the size of a toaster. There were some folks, however, who wanted to take Super 8 into a more professional realm. Designing a double system setup was the way to do this. One would need a camera running in perfect sync with an audio recorder. This was referred to as double system because one system recorded your film while a second system recorded your audio. There were several double system setups on the market. Bell and Howell was the first in the pool with the release of their Filmosound 8 in 1968. However, the Bell and Howell system was not reliable and was pulled from the market in short shrift. The system Richard Leacock designed at MIT used a Sony cassette recorder to capture sound. At Harvard, Bob Doyle modified a Sony reel-to-reel quarter-inch machine to record on Super 8 Full Coat, a fully coated magnetic film that was 8 millimeters wide and sprocketed for 8 millimeter use. For 16 millimeter productions, 16 millimeter full coat was a standard tool of the trade. After shooting, you would edit your film on a flatbed editing system or an editing bench with a sync block to run your picture and your audio simultaneously. When you completed your edit, you would still have separate reels of audio and picture. You would then add a sound stripe to your film and transfer your audio to the newly minted sound stripe on the film. That's a quick glance at the whole process, but which cameras would work for double system? It's complicated. Some cameras came equipped with single frame switches that could send out a sync pulse to your audio recorder. Some cameras were designed with the ability to send out a pilotone sync pulse to your recorder. Some equipment utilized highly accurate crystals to ensure that both camera and sound recorder ran at the same speed. This process was called crystal sync, which alleviated the need to connect the two devices with a physical tether. Regardless, the ultimate goal was to send a pulse between the camera and recorder that would allow them to maintain sync over the course of shooting. Underwater photography. Believe it or not, you could shoot Super 8 underwater. Reasonably priced housings were made to accommodate Kodak, Fuji, Beaulieu, Bell & Howell, and Umig cameras, to name a few. For under $200, you could begin to explore the icy depths of your favorite body of water in Super 8. Essay. My First Camera. To say I was a self-taught filmmaker is a bit of a lie. I did take one Super 8 class and one 3/4-inch video production class in college. I have little recollection of the topics covered or what cameras we used in those classes. In my Super 8 class, I made a pretentious film about how college libraries were soul-sucking. The film was black and white, somewhat stultifying, and definitely silent. This leads me to believe that we only had access to silent cameras. But a silent world was not for me. I needed sound. How else would my characters project their potty-mouthed missives? It was 1985, so finding a new camera was a challenge. Part of the problem was that I didn't even know where to look for a new camera. Very few stores were still carrying Super 8 cameras, but given that Super 8 was a home movie medium, it was easier to ask around to see who already had one. I found my guy, Mike Woolson. He was great. He had a shock of red hair, was a budding young cartoonist, had a worldview influenced by Mad Magazine, and had an unhealthy fixation on all things Adam West-era Batman. It helped that we were friends and worked together on an underground National Lampoon-inspired college humor magazine. Relevant to me was that Mike had a camera, and he wasn't using it all that much. Was it a good camera? Was it a bad camera? I had no clue, but it was a camera, and Mike was willing to lend it to me, so it pretty much checked off all my boxes. As it turned out, his GAF 805M was pretty sleek. Most Super 8 enthusiasts never seemed that hot on the GAF cameras. They didn't have the cachet of the more highly sought-after brands, but I loved this camera. It had a killer lens. It sported a 7.5mm to 60mm zoom lens, which was a big zoom range for Super 8, and 60mm was long for the Super 8 world. It was a sound camera, and it was solid. This GAF was a hefty brick. Perhaps best of all, it looked pretty darn cool. The folks at the General Aniline and Film Corporation, GAF, clearly were willing to think outside the box when it came to industrial design. Check out the handle design on the 805M. This is not how the handles on most Super 8 cameras looked. Most cameras had a rectangular or slightly rounded handle that ran perpendicular or at a slight angle to the camera's base. All told, most cameras exhibited some pretty meat-and-potatoes industrial design when it came to handles, at least compared to GAF models. Most of the cameras pictured in this book will attest to that. And let me tell you, people were afraid of the GAF handles. Whenever I shot with my 805M, I got quizzical glances. It was viewed with distrust. But I loved it. It had a good weight and felt properly balanced. I had no complaints. Between 1985 to 1987, I shot four of my early sound films with that camera. In 1987, it was time for me to pull up stakes in Ann Arbor and head west. The camera had been on permanent loan from Mike, but now I needed to turn that loan into a personal holding. I made him an offer. $80. Sold. The camera was mine. That camera served me faithfully. From 1987 to 1996, I made another seven films with it. When making my 1996 film, I'm Not Fascinating, the camera temporarily stopped working, forcing me to use some lesser models for the bulk of that film. Subsequently, I was able to revive the GAF, but its days were numbered as I was growing less confident in its reliability. As luck would have it, a better model came along. My new permanent loan was the highly sought-after Canon 1014 XLS. Not much could compare to the 1014 XLS, and my beloved GAF was relegated to the back of the closet. Mechanics aside, the GAF's body began to give out. Its plastic, metal, and rubber parts seemed to be corroding in front of my eyes. It was as if the camera had leprosy. Every time I picked it up, I was left coated in a black, rubbery ooze that was really hard to wash off. For the most part, I couldn't even figure out where this glop was coming from. The handle? The body? It didn't make any sense. What I could ascertain was that the eye cup was clearly a culprit. After shooting, I looked like Spot from The Little Rascals with a big black circle tattooed around my eye. Alas, the GAF had a good run. It now sits in a cupboard in the basement, entombed in bubble wrap. R.I.P. Interview. Bob Doyle, bringing double system to the Super 8 world. Bob Doyle was one of the pioneering architects of double system sound, which led him to start Super 8 Sound in Boston in 1972. I talked with him about the origins of the idea and the research and development necessary to pull off this technical feat. Super 8 Sound was at the forefront of professionalizing Super 8 production. Doyle left the company in 1977. Super 8 Sound moved to California in 1987 and morphed into Pro 8mm in 1998. What was your interest in Super 8 before you developed Double System and started Super 8 Sound? I was an assistant director of my Harvard College Observatory in the Department of Astronomy. At Harvard, I was a visiting member of one of the Harvard houses. We were all expected to support students and things they wanted to do. A junior at Harvard, Robert Cole, wanted to make a movie for an astronomy class instead of writing a paper. The professor in the course asked him to work with me. I said, "Okay, I'll build you a system." I had been making home movies with the Bell and Howell Filmosound, which predated any kind of a double system. It had a tape recorder and a projector. You could record with a camera and the tape recorder, and then you would play it back with their projector. It seemed nice, but it was clumsy, and it really wasn't full double system. I learned Ricky Lee.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.